live stream internet broadcast. We call this little show Live from the Newsroom. It's where we take the people and the issues that are making headlines here in Delaware County. We bring them into our newsroom in beautiful downtown Primos, and we talk about the issues of the day. We are once again tonight out on the road, as is our custom, sort of our home away from home. We are once again on the gorgeous campus of Widener University in Chester, Pennsylvania, where actually the Delaware County Daily Times heart still resides, the former Chester Times. And we've come back tonight here in Freedom Hall, home of the communications department at Widener, to their sparkling TV studio for a couple of very, very special reasons. One, this is our last show of the semester. The people here at Widener have invited us the last couple of years to partner with them. We do the show here once a month. It gives the opportunity for the students here in the communications department under the tutelage of Professor Tim Sapansky to get some real hands-on experience with a live internet broadstream broadcast. And it gives us the opportunity to take advantage of this tremendous equipment that we somehow have not quite yet been able to figure into our capital budget at the Daily Times to build our TV studio. But we're also here tonight for another very, very special reason. We're going to talk about this place, this Widener University, and it's fitting that we are here in one of the newer buildings here on campus, because we're going to talk about just how dramatically this campus has changed over the past decade and change. And we're going to do that through the eyes and ears of the man who has really masterfully charted that course over the last 13 years. And we're also going to be doing it with a touch of sadness, because we are joined tonight by Widener President Dr. James Harris. And we're going to celebrate all that is Widener tonight. And we're also going to do it, as I said, with just a touch of sadness, because after 13 years, Dr. Harris is going to be leaving Widener at the end of this summer. He's accepting a similar post at the University of San Diego. Dr. Harris, welcome to the show. Welcome back, I should say. You've been with us before. Let me start by asking you this. It did not escape my notice that the announcement that you were leaving Widener and Chester and Delaware County and heading to San Diego came in the midst of one of the worst winters we've ever had. So I know that they really had to twist your arm and tell you, well, you could come out to San Diego, but tell us a little bit about that decision.
Well, first of all, Phil, thanks for having me, and thanks for what you do for our communication studies students. This is a wonderful opportunity. We always talk about experiential learning at Widener, and this is hands-on experience that you're providing. To work with a professional with your experience is just fantastic. So thanks for doing this.
They can make me look good. They have the future. nothing could stop them in the future.
They have a great future ahead. Yeah. Now, the joke with one of my trustees the day that we announced it was 17 degrees here, and it was 71 degrees in San Diego, and they said it just wasn't fair to do so.
That's the first thing that I thought of.
No, no.
A reminder to our viewers, we're an interactive show. We've been soliciting some questions for Dr. Harris through the day through DelcoTimes.com. You can also log on to DelcoTimes.com and take part in our live chat. Also, a reminder that in addition to being live for the half hour, the show is actually archived on DelcoTimes.com, so that you can go back, watch the show, and see what other questions that you have. Let me ask you a little bit about the move itself, Dr. Harris. What was the instigation behind the move? Did they approach you?
They approached me in the fall. Actually, I had been contacted a number of times over the last year by the University of San Diego. Mm-hmm. The first time was by an alum. I serve on a national board. She served on that national board with me. And she came up to me. I was at Caltech last year in the spring, and she said, "Do you know that the University of San Diego is going to be looking for a president?" And I had no idea, no particular interest. She said, "You'd be good for that job." And then later in the summer, I was traveling on a train with someone. I actually sat down next to a woman from Washington, D.C., who we began talking about careers and so forth, and she mentioned that she was actually conducting or helping them with the search for the University of San Diego.
How about that?
So I don't know if that's providential or what's going on here, but I was approached in October by AGB Search. It seemed interesting. I'd not been in a job interview or allowed my name to go forward for 13 mm-hmm. years. And when I looked at the mission, I'm a Roman Catholic. It's a Roman Catholic institution. Yeah. And looked at whether or not it would be a fit. It seemed like the right move at the right time.
Let's go back, if you would, to 13 years and talk about you're originally from Ohio, correct?
I am from Northwestern Ohio.
Yeah, and your background there?
Before I came to Widener, I was the president of a school called Defiance College, and I was there mm-hmm. for 8 years. And I grew up in Northwestern Ohio. I'm a first-generation college student. My parents both grew up in that northwestern Ohio as well, so I'm a native.
Yeah. All right, let's talk a little bit about these 13 years. If you can encapsulate for us, how's the school changed over that 13 years?
I don't know that I can have a pithy statement for it, Phil, but I would say that if there was one thing how it's changed, it's that the university has honed and decided to become mission-driven. Mm-hmm. And that over the years, we've grown into an institution that clearly understands its mission, what we're all about, and that is really to help develop young men and women to be leaders and to be good citizens upon graduation. Yeah. And I think we've done a fine job. The faculty are fantastic here. Yeah.
What's the thing you're most proud of over those 13 years?
I think it's spelling out the mission and understanding that we all have a role to play with that mission and trying to build a sense of esprit de corps behind that mission of civic engagement at the university. Yeah. There's a survey that's done every 3 years by the Chronicle of Higher Education called The Great Colleges to Work For. And in that survey, there's a section that, and it's sent anonymously to our faculty and to our staff, so they can answer in any way they wish these different questions. One of the questions asks whether or not they believe in and understand how their job helps to deliver and advance the mission of the institution. Yeah. At Widener, those numbers are over 93% for faculty, 94% of staff and administrators say they understand and try to live out our mission. Mm-hmm. That's way off the chart for other institutions like us across the country. Mm-hmm. So that kind of awareness of who we are and what we're about and what we value, I think, is really critical and why we've been successful.
Yeah. As I said, Dr. Harris has been here at Widener for 13 years. That encompasses the time as well that I've been at the Daily Times and DelcoTimes.com. I've actually been there just a little bit longer than that. But I will tell you personally, one of the things that I have noticed specifically about the school, and I think that your mission has a lot to do with that, and that is, when I first started coming down here and speaking to communications classes and everything, I've always been fascinated by the interaction of the kids here attending Widener with the city of Chester.
Right.
And I can tell you that some of the times that I first started coming down here, I would ask kids, well, what do you know about Chester? And you know, some of them had never walked off this campus. It seems to me now that this school and these students are very much more a part of this city of Chester, PA, rather than simply this intellectual island in the middle of Chester, Pennsylvania. Is that part of the mission?
That's a big part of the mission, is really to engage your local community. If you're going to ask students upon graduation to be good citizens, then the university has to be a good citizen. And our students and our faculty members have found these wonderful ways that actually prepare them better for life after graduation by working in Chester. I've said for a number of years that I thought Chester actually provides a great learning ground for our students in preparation for life, and that Widener is positioned in a really unique position on the north side of Chester. I've used the 2 miles south, 2 miles north analogy. Yep. So if you go 2 miles north of here, you're in one of the wealthiest per capita communities in the East Coast. Yep. You have one of the best educated communities. You have one of the best public high schools. And if you go south of here, you're talking about a city that has deep issues of poverty, that has issues that I think less than 10% of the adult population possess a college degree. So you start thinking about that, but the schools are not performing at the level we'd like them to perform. Yeah. And our students have experiences in both those communities, and that's what our society looks like. And so if you have those experiences, you're going to be better prepared.
Yeah. One of the things that you talked about, obviously, is the idea of civic engagement along with the global engagement, and the mission statement at Widener to integrate kids into that mission. What are some of the ways specifically that you've tried to instill that here on the campus at Widener?
I think one of the ways that we've tried to instill it is to let the ingenuity and creativity of the faculty shine. Mm-hmm. So every field, you've had some of your guests. So for example, in January, you had Jill Black on your show to talk about the physical therapy clinic.
Right.
And that's a great example of physical therapy faculty looking at different ways for our students to have experiences. Our alumni are involved with that. I think Widener Partnership Charter School is a great example, and that was really an initiative from not just the School of Education, but also from social work and physical therapy, and all the nursing have all been involved in certain ways in that school. So it's an interdisciplinary approach. But every one of these ideas that we've had, nursing clinic, physical therapy, the clinic to help prevent violence in the city of Chester, all these initiatives really have come from great ideas from faculty who are trying to live out our mission. And so it's allowing them to be creative. They're brilliant to begin with, and then allowing them to be creative has helped build our mission and gives our students these just incredible experiences.
Yeah. One of the things that we mentioned, again, the fact is that we are here on the campus of Widener in the city of Chester, and obviously the city has its issues. It is undergoing something of an economic renaissance, particularly when you look at areas along the waterfront. There is some sure seeds of an economic rebirth there. You're looking at the construction of Harris Casino, and then that was followed by the wharf at Rivertown with the restoration of the Pico Power Station, and now we have the PPL Park and literally a major league soccer franchise, which calls Chester its home. But in addition to that, one of the things that I've always talked about with city officials is that one of their challenges is to take some of that growth and literally drag it across Route 291 and have it feed out into both the downtown and some of the neighborhoods. And actually, Widener plays a big part in that economic renaissance here in the city. What are some of the things that the college is doing in pushing that economic growth here in the city?
Absolutely. In addition to what I mentioned earlier, where we have faculty that have prepared students by having classes that are based in the discipline. Mm-hmm. So we have faculty in business, for example, that are working on issues with businesses in the local community. But for example, the Small Business Development Center has incubated dozens and dozens of businesses. Some of my favorites, Cheryl's Southern Cooking, which has not been good for my waistline here. Fatso Donut has used that center to help it develop its marketing plan and so forth. So I think that that's one really critical way with economic development. Then we've been a participant in helping develop the economy next to our campus. So for example, we were the first university in the country that we're aware of that actually turned back property that we didn't pay taxes on because we're nonprofit.
Right.
We actually turned that back, and University Crossings, which was developed, I think about 8 years ago now that it's been standing, and brought to Chester for the first time a new hotel, a new bank, the 7-Eleven, and so forth. They hadn't had those services for a number of years. And we leased that property for $1 a year for 65 years, and it brought a $25 million investment to the city of Chester. University Technology Park, which started actually before I came, and then the second building was built my third year here. That's another way to incubate new businesses, to help, and we have such a great location, if you think about it. We're right on the corridor of 95 and the Blue Route and all the opportunities to come and go through the city. So we've been trying to play a major role. And then we also have something called the Riverfront Alliance, which has just been recently renamed, which was used to be the Institute for Economic Development.
We had them on
and
shows
and Mike
as
McGee,
well.
And they've done a fine job. And so getting all the major players, all the major employers together on a regular basis to talk about how are we going to promote economic development. And there are some initiatives that are being discussed about how that might, how we might even help in a greater way, similar to what's happened in Camden, where they have the Cooper's Ferry model. And so that might be a model that a place like Chester would like to take a look at in the future.
Let's talk a little bit about the school itself. Let's talk a little bit about enrollment, where enrollment stands now as opposed to where it stood when you arrived 13 years ago.
You know, that's a great question. I don't know exactly the numbers. I know that we had set very ambitious goals for our undergraduate population for the 10 years that we had in what we called Vision 2015, which we started in 2004, and we reached those goals.
Sounded a long way away.
It did.
2015, we're never going to get to that.
but we reached those goals within 5 years, and then we increased them again, and we reached them. Today, I know that I think it's been 9 out of the last 10 years, we've had the largest freshman classes in our history. But more importantly, in the last 3 years, they're the best academically prepared classes that we've ever had, and they're also the most diverse classes that we've had. Today, I was looking at numbers yesterday where we have twice as many international students as we did 3 years ago. I think the number was around 100, now it's over 200 students just on this campus. And so that diversity, I think, adds to the educational programming. So undergraduate programs have grown. Graduate programs we try to keep level because, for example, our physical therapy program, our clinical psychology program, our national programs, less than 10% of the students that apply are admitted, and we have hundreds that admit and try to get into it. So those are capped. Where we've had some issues has been at the School of Law. And I mean, I know people will make jokes that, well, we don't need any more attorneys anyway, but there has been a real drop in a need and a desire for legal education. And so students have decided not to enter legal education. Mm-hmm. And so those numbers have dropped significantly over the last 4 years.
Yeah.